You know, our president is waiting on some big things tonight. He's waiting to hear what will happen with the allegations against his Supreme Court pick, waiting to actually read the Russia investigation documents that he's forcing his intelligence community to make public, and still waiting to hear where the negotiations between his lawyers and Bob Mueller go. The president's lawyer, Jay Sekulow, can speak to all of these issues with unique connection and competence. Counselor, welcome to primetime.
Thank you, Chris, for having me. I appreciate it. Look forward to being with you.
All right, so let's make the most of this opportunity.
Sure.
Kavanaugh,
yep.
This is a weird one, right? We struggle with this. There is no trial. So
right.
How do you deal with the burdens? How do you deal with the presumptions? How do you deal with process in an overtly political context, which this is, right?
Yeah.
The call right now is, by the Democrats and by Professor Ford, let the FBI take a look, and then I will come in and answer whatever you want. Fair ask.
So here's how it works. I mean, this is the way the Constitution's. I think Dr. Ford should get a fair hearing. I completely agree with that, the idea that she should have a fair opportunity to present her case. But the way it works, though, as you said, Chris, this is not a trial. So this is a proceeding before the Senate. So let's look at what the Constitution says. Constitution says the president has the right to nominate judges and justices. They actually don't even use the phrase justices.
That's
it says
right.
Judges to the Supreme Court of the United States. Okay, so he did that with Brett Kavanaugh. Then the Senate, under their authority, has the advice and consent role. That's not just a rubber stamp. That is a process. That process is underway. Now there's been an allegation. So I think the safest thing to do here is to follow the Constitution. Now, I'm not going to get into whether 2 days or 3 days or it should be Monday or whatever. That's the Senate's role here. I think that Dr. Ford should be given an opportunity to appear and to make the case. I think that Judge Kavanaugh should be able to respond to that. I think that's appropriate. By the way, doesn't mean it has to be done publicly. They could decide that if the Dr. Ford, I understand the transparency issue, but if Dr. Ford wanted to do it privately, I think she'd have the right to do that.
Well, they've offered her that. There's no question.
Yes, they have.
And look, I get the sensitivities. I mean, she has the threats.
Sure.
She's got kids. Her family is not living at home right now. I totally
right.
get that. But,
sure.
you know, for the full complement of senators to make an assessment, for the rest of us to have any confidence in what happens there, especially given the poison politics of this confirmation process, I think it's going to have to be open. But this
you said something really important there, Chris, and that is that for the Senate to have its role, and I think what's getting overlooked, and you haven't done this, but others have, and that's overlooking the Senate's role here. This is a situation where the United States Senate is vested with the advice and consent role.
Right.
And that means that they can have the hearing, they can vote yes or vote no, they determine
right.
veracity, and they determine process. That is the appropriate venue
right.
constitutionally for
But
this.
There's a this and that issue here that I think you're neglecting with all due respect, Counselor, which is
sure.
the FBI is not a stranger to this process. They do the background assessments every time with judicial nominees, and you have precedent here. With Anita Hill, when that came forward as an allegation, President Bush said to the FBI, take a look. They took a few days, they took a look, they said, we can't corroborate this. It then leaked, and you wound up having public hearings. The same mechanism could be in place here. The president could go back to the FBI, who already did a background review, which they always do. The Congress cannot go back to the FBI and say, reopen the background. That's at the White House's direction. But he can, and do exactly what President Bush did. Why not?
Well, I'm not going to speak. I'm not the president's White House counsel, so that's not my job to
don't
interject.
Don't hedge, Sekulow.
No, Chris. Now, look, we're being fair here.
All right.
I don't get to determine the policy and process that the White House engages in. That's not my job. My job is to look at, and the reason we're talking about this tonight is, look, a serious allegation has been raised. It needs to be handled appropriately. I go to the Constitution and say, let's look at what the way the process should work out. I don't think anybody actually disagrees with that.
Well, but the
question
FBI
that you're asking
every
is,
time,
what should the FBI do or not do? Now, let's look at that process, too. Number one, and I think you've acknowledged this the other night, the FBI is not, in this particular case, looking at a criminal action
right.
investigation. So
right.
for those that are watching the broadcast, I think it's important to point out, what would the FBI do? If the FBI were to do an investigation or
right.
a follow-up, it's basically a follow-up to their report that they give to Congress,
yes.
that they would give to the White House if it was asked for. And that's the way the process would go out. So again, I'm not one that gets to make the policy decision on that.
I get it, but what's wrong with that?
Well, it's not a question of what's wrong with it. It's who makes that decision. It's not
the president would have to make the
decision. Well, not the president's private lawyers.
I understand. No, I totally get it.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is this. I'm just asking you this as a legal mind right
sure.
now. We'll get more and more specific to your current state of employment with the lawyer and on these separate issues. But on this one, the president can make the call, right? Absolutely. Presidents
sure.
have made the call in the past. And at a minimum, it would ensure a little bit of more confidence in an overtly untrustworthy process, because everybody's got a political agenda. Why wouldn't he want to give his own nominee the best look he can? Because Kavanaugh's got to want to have people look into this also.
Look, I don't know what the president's thinking is on that. I don't know what the White House counsel's thinking is on that. Again, that's not my responsibility. But what I do think is important here, there's been a serious allegation made. Mm-hmm. There needs to be due process. It's not in the, again, not in the court system that we're talking about here, within the Senate. And the Senate can, look, this, they're putting these people under oath. I mean, Brett Kavanaugh, Judge Kavanaugh, and Dr. Ford, they go under oath. So it's under the penalty of perjury for all the parties that are witnesses. And I think that then in that case, that's the way to do this. I think it needs to be fair. Again, whether it should be Monday or Wednesday or whatever the period of time is. Look, the Supreme Court starts its term, was it the first Monday in October? Which I think this year's October 1st. Will Brett Kavanaugh be confirmed by then or not? I don't know. Again, because that's not my job here. My job, as I'm looking at this as an observer. I am not giving advice on this. Obviously, it's not my role. But I think, look, this, again, needs to be done appropriately, it needs to be done properly, and it needs to get a fair hearing. For both, look, for both individuals involved in this. And I don't discount the seriousness of this. I think anybody that is making a mistake. But I also don't think that, that Judge Kavanaugh should be just left out there. I think there needs to be a full and fair process. And how that process looks, again, Chris, that's not just my decision here.
100%.
I mean, that's not my decision actually at all.
100%.
And that's the Senate. You know, the Senate has a big role here, as you know.
Yeah.
And they're going to make
decisions. They just can't call in the FBI. The president does. That's why I was asking you about it.
Yeah,
let's take one step closer to your official role with Sessions.
Yeah.
Hasn't anybody explained to the president that Sessions had no choice but to recuse himself? You know all the DOJ guidelines. But just for the audience, if we have it, put it up of what the rule is here, that if you have a connection to anybody who's in going to be a subject of or in any way affected by an investigation, you must recuse. Where is the surprise for the president?
Well, look, the recusal took place before the president. First of all, I've said this before, and you know this, and the reports have been out there. The recusal took place before this was an inquiry like this. I mean, let's look at this. So I will tell you that I understand the president's frustration in this situation. And I think if you were in the situation, you would too. Having said that, look, there was a process that was followed. Do I think, and I think you could get lawyers that could agree and disagree. I will tell you this. And I know my colleague Rudy Giuliani has opined on this as well. But I think, look, the recusal, and everybody needs to remember this, when did the recusal take place? Before what? Before the appointment of all of this. Before the appointment of the special counsel, there was recusal. Well, I mean, so that tells you that the frustration point, it wasn't where some, you just gave the regulation.
Right.
That regulation
put it up on
really
the screen
had,
just so people can see
the
it as we speak.
Sure, yeah. The regulation has nothing to do with, in this sense, of what actually transpired. Sure, there's internal regulations. But the recusal issue is one that, look, General Sessions made that decision. I don't think it was the right decision. There are people that could disagree. I get that. It's a, you know, people can disagree. Reasonable minds can take different positions here. But let's be clear. It was before there was any special counsel appointment. So that to me, I think it was, again, I understand
why. But
there
was an ongoing investigation. It was going to involve all of the different checks, you know, that they have to think about with that guideline. And then the president says, if I had known, I would have picked somebody else. Okay, fair point. You had a chance.
Well, really a fair point.
But I'm saying fair point. I get it.
Significant point, yeah.
I get it. So you would have wanted somebody else. Okay, you had a chance. You had Rosenstein. The president picked Rosenstein after the recusal. And as we know, the president and Sessions both massaged a situation with Rosenstein where he wrote that very favorable memo
I think that's
Jim
an unfair character.
So
you don't
that
know
was
what
his
the,
guy.
But you, hey, first of all, Chris, you're making an assumption. You just said, if I heard you correctly, you said that Rosenstein, Rod Rosenstein, massaged a memo?
I'm saying that
the president and Sessions massaged
the situation
Rosenstein. What's your basis for that?
Because they brought him in.
What evidence do you have of that?
Timing. He was brought
in.
Yeah, well, it counts.
Okay,
hear me out and then object as you like.
Yep.
He comes in. He is then asked to write a letter about Comey and assess.
How do you know this?
Well, how did it happen?
Well, how do you know this?
What, did he just do it on a whim?
Well, let me ask you this question.
It was reported as such.
Chris,
yes,
sir. You and I have been friends. Do you understand? Do you have the facts on that to support that? It's been reported.
Yeah.
But, you know, has Rod Rosenstein testified to that? That he was massaged? No. I mean, let's go back to what
you're talking about the massaging. Why did he write the letter, Jay?
Well, why did he write the letter? But I assume he wrote the letter because he thought that James Comey should not be the FBI director.
Who told him to make the assessment?
Well, do you think it? Who do you know who told him?
I think somebody had to tell him because he wouldn't have just done it on his own. He came in to be the deputy acting, and the first thing he decides to do is just write a letter about how Jim Comey's got to go with the FBI?
Well,
nobody asked him to do it?
Here's the problem. You're making a factual assumption that you have no basis to stay.
That's not true. I do have basis.
Has Rod Rosenstein testified that he did this just because the president ordered him to, which is what you just said, basically? He has not testified to that.
Let's parse it. Have I heard Rosenstein say, I only did this because the president told me to? No.
Okay.
That Rosenstein did this at the direction or suggestion of other people? Absolutely. Okay. Why?
Well, Chris, look.
Nothing else makes sense.
Well, how do you know that?
Why else would he have written
Let me give you
letter.
A for instance. Because in an election, James Comey, and if you want to play the clips of Chuck Schumer and others, who said James Comey
hated him.
Why?
Because they felt that he tilted the election in favor or away from their candidate.
He violated a Department of Justice guideline. Well, that's what happened. Okay, so he was fired. And in looking at it, Rod Rosenstein makes an assessment.
Why did he look at it?
Well, because he was sworn in.
He made the assessment before he was fired. So why did he do it?
Well, you tell me. You think it's because the president ordered
him.
I'm not rejecting your explanation. What I'm saying is Rod Rosenstein made a determination.
Yes.
And made a recommendation to the president.
Yes.
And that was also signed by the attorney general.
Yes.
So, and the president acted on that. And that's completely...
Maybe not, because the president doesn't say that.
But do you think that, first of all, constitutionally under Article 2, you know this, Chris, you're a good lawyer.
He can hire and fire.
Absolutely. James Comey said that.
Not for bad reason, though.
Hold it. The Constitution is very clear on this.
It's actually absent on it. It says hire or fire. It doesn't say any reason whatsoever.
The Constitution actually doesn't say hire and fire.
Not even if it's illegal and nefarious.
Chris, the Constitution doesn't say hire and fire. That's not in the Constitution. It's the Article 2 authority of a president to hire and fire. Not because the Constitution doesn't have the word hire and fire. That's right. The impact of the plenary authority of the President of the United States.
Understood.
So,
but there's got to be a check on that. It has to be reasonable that the firing can't be for bad or corrupt reasons.
What if the president thought James Comey was doing a bad job?
Then he could fire him.
So you're now saying that a third party could come in, under your theory, and come in and say, we want to examine the President of the United States' intent as to why he took an action under his Article II authority.
Yes.
Then what prevents every U.S. attorney that doesn't like a decision, put this president aside, that any president makes, what prevents that U.S. attorney, from saying, I want to subpoena the president and find out why he fired the undersecretary
You have to pass legal muster.
Well, what does that mean? What does legal muster mean under your theory?
That you have legal sufficiency. In this case, if they're pursuing an obstruction.
By the way, who are you showing that legal sufficiency to? It's not a court proceeding. So who are you showing the legal sufficiency to? So here's the problem.
But you have the same guy that you put in that the president asked to guide him and give him suggestions about Comey.
Well, can I ask you a question about that? Let's assume that was the fact for a moment.
No, it is the fact. Rosenstein said it.
Okay, so let's say it. So is there anything wrong with the president asking the deputy attorney general for a recommendation on James Comey's employment as the FBI director?
I would say no. However, one step backwards.
Right.
One, you were questioning whether that ever happened.
I'm saying...
I don't know that the president ever massaged this situation. Yes, I do. He asked Rosenstein for a suggestion about what to do on Comey.
Is that a violation of his article? You think that's a violation of the law?
It's a matter of fact.
No, Chris.
I'm saying it's a matter of fact.
That's fine. Does that violate a law?
I'm not saying it does. You said, how do you know the president has to do it?
Well, I don't know how you know other than...
Rosenstein said it.
No, Rosenstein said he did not say he did it on the president's behalf.
He said the president asked him
for
counsel and suggestion. So he wrote the letter.
So let me ask you a question. Is that not appropriate for a president to ask?
One step at a time. I'm saying that's why he did it. You said, how do you know? Now I'm telling you how I know.
So is it appropriate for a president to ask the deputy attorney?
100%.
It's very different than massaging it.
Yes.
Because you're trying to give a nefarious intent here.
That's my suggestion. That's my characterization based on what I understand.
And I'm telling you, if the president of the United States, any president of the United States, asks their attorney general or deputy attorney general for advice, which, by the way, is what their job is, then if he acts on that advice, he shouldn't be investigated for acting on their advice.
But there's a but here. Because then what happens? Yes, It all worked perfectly. Rosenstein gave him this letter. It was damning of Comey. Free, clear. Go ahead, get rid of him. You have
Do you think Rod Rosenstein's lying?
No, it's not about lying. Okay. So listen. So he writes that letter. This is his opinion. He can't be lying about his opinion, right? Unless he gave it in bad faith, and I have no reason to believe that.
Right.
So the president does the interview with Lester Holt and says, I was going to fire him anyway because I said this Russia thing, it's just not right. I'm getting rid of him.
That's actually.
So he blows the Rosenstein letter out of the water and makes
actually,
it clear
not
that he acted on it because he was pissed off about what Comey was doing with him on the probe.
There's actually a transcript of the entire Lester Holt interview.
Mm-hmm.
And as you know, because you do TV and do a good job.
Thank you.
You know that when there are interviews, there are edits. And there is a longer transcript. And I will just tell you, without disclosing any detail, that when you review the entire transcript, it is very clear as to what happened. And I'm not going to give you information on how we provided it, but in our professional discussions with the Office of Special Counsel, we've addressed that on multiple occasions appropriately. And the evidence, when you look at the entire evidence, and you don't see it. And I'm not, by the way, I'm not faulting anybody for running a clip or this. But to turn that into literally a federal case, we don't think is right. We don't think it's constitutional. And we think the entire transcript, without question, supports that the president realized that when he fired James Comey, it might actually extend this investigation. And he said that on the tape.
Look, not that it's the most compelling evidence. But then you have a scene afterwards with the Russians in the Oval Office, where the president says to them, now a lot of pressure's off me now that I got rid of Comey with this whole Russia deal. Well, look, if it wasn't on his mind, if it wasn't a motivation for him, legal or illegal, right or wrong, it was clearly in his mind about why he wanted to get rid of Comey.
But again, you're acting as if that's not a constitutional right, if that was, in fact, what was in his mind. And again, that's speculation. But I think that that's what we have to be clear here. So I have to look at what the law is, as the evidence exists, and what the law is. And when you get to the Article II issue, it's a very serious moment constitutionally for our country if a president's decision-making on what's called inferior officers, that's not in a pejorative way, it's just the way the Constitution, that's what the Constitution and the rules and regulations say. And to say that you can then cross-examine, so to speak, the president, any president, on that decision, very dangerous. And that's
exactly
the reason we have
separation of powers. You wouldn't suggest that you should never do it, would you?
Never do what?
Would you suggest that you should never question a president's actions with respect to an inferior officer ever?
Well, I think the constitutional hurdle that you have to cross over to get into that, which doesn't exist here, you try to put that into a perspective. And what would be the standard on
when you believe that there was corrupt intent, illegal intent?
What would be the illegality? Do you think a president could shut down an investigation if that president has decided to do it? Hasn't happened here, by the way. Despite all the protests to the contrary, the president hasn't done that. Do you think that a president has the constitutional authority to shut down an investigation? It's not complicated, but it's historical fact that it happens.
But
it's not happened here. So you know what?
Well,
the fact is,
guess who's still there?
Jeff Sessions is still the attorney general, and Bob Mueller is still the special
counsel. Well, Jeff
Sessions,
he could move on because he recused himself. I don't know why he isn't, frankly. He drags the guy all through the mud. He embarrasses him, and I believe you could argue embarrasses the White House at the same time because of the way he speaks about his attorney general. But he keeps him there. I don't know why. But
That's not, you know what? You and I don't get to make that decision.
I know, but I get to report on it and analyze.
Sure.
That's all I'm doing.
Absolutely.
Do whatever you want.
Report.
You're the president.
But, and the president decided that Jeff Sessions, as of now, is the attorney general.
But,
he hasn't moved him out.
But if Sessions were in charge of the Russia probe, which certainly involves the president, and then he removed him, when it seemed that it was getting inconvenient, when it seemed that it was pressuring him, when he didn't like it, now I think you have a different question,
and that's why
obstruction of justice comes in.
Except for one thing, one factual flaw. Where are we right now? Over a year into the investigation, is Bob Mueller still the special counsel?
Yes.
Has he been fired?
No.
Right.
But why is that the end of it? We're talking about Jim Comey.
Well, let's talk about this.
We're talking about Jim Comey and why he got rid of Jim Comey. And why Mueller wants to talk to the president about that decision.
You don't know what Bob Mueller wants to talk about.
I believe that Bob Mueller wants to talk to the president about why he fired Jim Comey.
And he believes that one of the reasons he's
pushing you for an interview is because he believes he can only get that understanding from the president himself.
Well, I mean, just think about what you said just then. I mean, and like I said, we're friends. Okay. You can only determine, in your view, what the status of the intent is by interviewing the president.
Yes.
So what prevents then every U.S. attorney from doing the same thing? You fire somebody, you don't like it, I think there's bad intent, so I'm going to interview him. Do you think the president should be subject to
subpoena?
But it's
not as simple a scenario as
that.
You have an investigation that involves the president. He removes the guy. He says he removed him because he didn't like the probe. And you want to know why.
If Hillary Clinton would have fired James Comey, would have that been okay?
Would he have been in the middle of an investigation that involved her and threatened her presidency?
Well, do you think she could not fire him?
Context matters, counselor.
That's what I'm saying. You think under the context of the election and listen, I was very critical. You know this, Chris. I was very critical about engaging and unengaging that took place during the campaign.
Right.
I thought that was.
I remember.
There's a policy that says don't do that.
He should have shut his mouth. I think that's fair consensus.
Okay. So he didn't. So he's now terminated. But you know what? Here's where we are. Let's talk about where we are because you've asked the question. So I'm not going to preempt you asking the question, but I know the question. So where are we? So we've been doing this now for a little over a year. We have provided over 30 witnesses.
Unprecedented.
To the office. Unprecedented. Over 1.4 million pages of material. Unprecedented. We have not done what President, and by the way, I'm not saying President Clinton didn't have the right to challenge the document productions that he did. He had the right to do it. We didn't do that here. That's not what my colleagues did. They provided the information. They provided the witnesses. So if you want to determine, and as you know, the president is very direct with what his opinions are and his positions. And you don't have to do a lot of investigating to determine that.
But it's different to speak to him directly.
Yes,
you know
but here's, yeah, but here's, well, look, Chris, here's the thing. I am representing with a team the president of the United States in his capacity individually. Then the White House has their own interests. And you got to be careful about precedents you're saying. But let me say this. We have had, and I think Bob Mueller would say this, a professional, ongoing dialogue with incredible transparency. Are we entitled in good faith to negotiate these various issues that you're about to raise
100%.
Or you are raising? Of course. That's our job.
100%.
That's the I'm not going to give you where it is in the negotiation. I'm not going to tell you what we told them.
It would be nice
them.
If you did, though, Jay, especially for your first appearance on the show.
Yeah. Chris?
In the interest of transparency?
I like you. I know. But I'm not going to do that for anybody. That would be inappropriate for me to give that information. But I will tell you this. The discussion's ongoing. I believe that there'll be resolutions of this because that's the way these processes tend to work. And we'll see what happens. And I'm convinced at the end of the day that if we stick to the Constitution on all of these issues, it tends to work out best for the country. And that's really important here. I think we all agree with that.
Rudy Giuliani suggested to me that I will not be asking you guys these questions about whether or not there'll be an interview after Thanksgiving. Do you still hold to that as a timeline?
Let me tell you one thing I have not done. Okay? I have not given a date. Despite a couple people, I have never given a date. I don't give dates. That is not the business I'm in. I'm advising the client. Now, Rudy,
It's not an exact date, it's just a period.
Yeah,
phase,
well, look, Rudy
season.
Has a lot more experience than I do in these kind of matters on this. I'm the constitutional lawyer here. Mm-hmm. So I look at the Article II issues, the issues you and I had a great discussion about. Rudy's job is different. He is the lead counsel in this, and he's evaluating those with our team. And that's the process we go through. And we all have a collaborative effort, as does the special counsel's office. And Rudy may be right. Maybe it is resolved by Thanksgiving. I think for the good of the country, it should be resolved really soon.
Well, if you want it wrapped up, you have to wrap this part up.
Well, you know what, though, Chris? This is, and I think you know this. Let's be blunt about this. This has not exactly been a regular investigation. I mean, the things that have transpired over the last year are pretty unprecedented. And I'm not going to go through starting with the Christopher Steele dossier and the text messages and all of this. But you have to look at all of the context. But despite that, we still have maintained, and the president has maintained, transparency and a commitment to giving documents unprecedented in history. And you acknowledge that, and it's true. I mean, that was the position that my colleagues took about giving information and putting that information forward to the special counsel's office, and they've done that.
But the key offer is him, and we'll see where that goes. We got deeper into Kavanaugh and this than I expected to, so let me get to one more thing. I don't want to take up too much of your time.
Yep.
People will not probably know this, but you represent Pastor Brunson,
yes.
All right? Who's Andrew Brunson? He is the pastor is being held by Turkey. The United States government believes it's for wrong reason. We thought that there was going to be a breakthrough, that he was going to be released, that Turkey would at a minimum be pressured to make a show of what espionage or what grand claim they have against him, and then it went quiet. Why?
Yep. Well, a couple things have happened. I really appreciate you bringing this up. First of all, the charge actually against Pastor Brunson, in the criminal indictment in Turkey is Christianization.
Right.
So what they believe is espionage is him, a pastor of a church of about 50 people in Izmir, Turkey. Look, this I believe it's a political moment. The president and the secretary of state, but the president's been very aggressive seeking his release. I do have some good news, and that he's returned to house arrest. Now, that's a lot better than being in a jail in Turkey, as you can imagine. But there's still an ongoing trial, and I will tell you this, the administration, the president in particular, vice president, secretary of state, are working diligently to secure his release, and the release means getting him home. But at least he is out of that jail, and that's a first step. But look, I think the politics of this are way beyond what we can deal with, and the fact is I really appreciate you raising it, because meanwhile, this pastor has missed his daughter getting married,
right,
graduations from school, and I can't even imagine the pressure. And I got to speak to him when he got, the first time I ever spoke to him, Chris, was when he was allowed to go home. He's under house arrest, so he can't leave.
Right.
But it was the first time I ever spoke to Andrew Brunson. We took the case once he was incarcerated. We thought it was going to be a short term, and they would basically extradite him out or just throw him out of the country, and they didn't.
Well, the trials there are so political that the concern is that if they allow the trial to end and you get a sentence, it then becomes much more entrenched in terms of
what
you
do. And you know the other thing, Chris, here is the trials. When we look at a trial and we say the trial is going to be 10 days, we think it's going to be 2 weeks. He's on day 4 of his trial. That'll be in October 12th. You know when the first day of the trial was? In March.
Right.
So they use that as a holding thing, too. I appreciate you bringing that up.
Yeah, no, look, we're going to stay on it. It matters. And Jay Sekulow, thank you for being on.
Chris,
I know that you'd been reluctant to come on. You're always welcome to come
on
here and make the case for the president of the United States.
Thanks, Chris.
Be well.